Rise for the Pledge of Allegiance, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call, please.
Beichtman? Basinger?
Present.
Boss?
Present.
Ekis?
Present.
Fry?
Present.
Gross?
Present.
Schroller?
Present.
Thrum?
Present.
We have a quorum.
Okay, the first item is approval of minutes. Darlene had one amendment. It's on page... Well, Denny was pressuring me to get started. He was 7 o'clock. He must have an eye for that.
I didn't. She stood up first.
Vicki was first up?
Yeah.
I knew you'd look up at some point.
There you go. That's good. Good?
Yeah.
Yep. All right. Thank you very much. The only amendment that I have right now is one from Darlene. It was on page 4 of the agenda. At the very top, the fourth sentence, where it starts with CM Schroller on the third line, she wants that changed to CM Boss and CM Schroller question the invoice to Dave's Body Shop in the amount of $5,764.22 on the 1996 Dodge Ram water/sewer truck, which includes a paint job for $1,144 and parts and labor for $3,145. And that is the only amendment I have.
Move to approve minutes of
the April 10th?
Pardon me, sir. Yes, so the regular meeting of the council on April 10th with one amendment.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? 7-0. The next item is a special meeting from April 13th. I do not have any amendments.
Move to approve a special meeting of April 13th, 2007, which was the purpose of looking at a couple dump trucks and a
crack sealer.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? 7-0. The next item is public comments. If you are not on the agenda, please come to the podium, give your name, your ward, your address, and you have up to 5 minutes to speak. All right, we'll move along to the business and discussion items. The first one is Lynn Bargman. Is Lynn here tonight? Okay, do you want to discuss that?
I assume I contacted you? Yeah, I thought he would be here. But he's asking for consideration to rent heads from Holligan for the pumpkin patch September 22nd through October 31st. Last year and in previous years, there's been a $25 rental fee.
And we haven't had any problems, have we?
No, not that I'm aware of.
Okay. Is there a motion to allow that?
Move to approve Lynn Bargman's request to rent heads from Hall September 22nd to October 31st. For the rental fee of $25 for the annual pumpkin patch.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? 7-0. The next item is Jim Swim. Jim, you get to share about a monarch conservation.
Madam Mayor and members of the council, thank you for allowing me to be on the agenda tonight. I'm Jim Swim. I live east of town in rural Marysville, and I have a little farm there. Recently, last summer, I did some conservation work on my farm. So when you tear up the ground and all, you kind of decide what kind of grass you want to put back in there, what kind of plants you want to grow. And I researched it fairly well, and I decided I might want to try to put in some milkweed and different nectar-bearing plants which would attract monarch butterflies. I did some research and I checked with the University of Kansas on their monarch butterfly research center down there. I've been down there through their center And if you haven't ever been there, it's very interesting to see. It's a building probably four times as large as this, and they have millions of monarch butterflies in there, and it's impressive. So at any rate, I thought that I would plant some nectar seeds or plants and milkweed, because I'm not an entomologist or an agronomist or anything, but monarch butterflies, they migrate through our area. And I talked to the research center, and we happen to be right on the migratory path for all these monarchs to go from Canada down to Mexico. So if we could attract some of those fellows to come in, monarchs are a pollinator as well as bees, and they help other flowers in the area. And they also, what they do, they come and they eat the nectar off of certain plants, and they lay eggs in milkweed. And the milkweed eggs hatch from that, and they make little worms that turn into monarch butterflies. So I checked on them, and this research center, they send out free plugs. So this is something the city could do with your approval and backing. That you could, that apparently you can get, they sent me, or they have on the way, $687 worth of plugs, milkweed plugs, free. I have to pay the freight on them, so it's going to cost me $70 to get these milkweeds in. But I observe in this community that we have, the city owns the cemetery, the airport, and you have city parks in the community. You also have a city dump out here. I don't know whether that's county or city or who owns that. But at any rate, it would be interesting to me to see some monarch habitat established free in some of these areas, along the fence lines, for instance. Now, whenever you undertake a project like this, it's going to take some manpower. And I don't know what the city has on that or anything, but I went ahead and, for my purposes, I checked with Craig Lister, who's a FFA teacher, instructor at Marysville High School. Presented this to him. Craig he's a major FFA instructor at the high school, but he has a horticultural instructor underneath him. And I don't know, it's a lady, I don't know what her name is, but they have a greenhouse and all. So I said, I'd like to hire a few kids to come out and help me plant. And if the city would be agreement of this, they might need some help too. Well, that'd be a real good class project. We could go out and do it for you. If you could get free seed, free plantings to do this, and get it put in the ground without having to use your city employees, it might be something to consider.
So you did this last year?
Huh?
You did this for the first time last year?
I haven't planted them yet.
Oh, okay. You just looked into it, so you haven't done any yet.
They're on the way. They're being shipped, right?
Yeah. I found out that they don't ship them until you pay the freight. So I immediately sent a check off to pay them. So I'm hopefully they'll come in. But they plant, you could get enough plugs to plant a couple acres. 1 acre, if you go in 4-foot strips, makes about a mile. It's 5,300 some feet. So an acre is a square of 216 feet. You can, geometrically, you can figure this out yourself. But if you have a seeder or a planter or an aerator, you might be able to go through it and just drop the seeds in it and you're done. Now the plugs, of course, would have to be put in the ground. They're just small plants. But Deb, did you get some information off that website?
I just printed the information on the milkweed for the agenda packet. I didn't know exactly.
Do sunflowers qualify as, you said they had to be nectar-bearing plants, so would sunflowers work?
Well, I have done this for my own purposes. I'm just sharing you with this information with you to, because most people aren't aware of this. I went to Burn Seed Company over at Home City, checked with them what kind of nectar-bearing plants I would have to put up with the milkweeds to attract butterflies. They said it cost $53 an acre to buy seed for nectar-bearing plants, and they have a mixture of 11 different plants. It's got bluebells and daffodils and all kinds of plants that are attracted to nectar-bearing, so they attract bees as well as butterflies.
Are milkweed considered a weed? Are milkweed weed?
I have this information they printed out. There's many different kinds of milkweed.
Would people?
I asked them the very same thing at the research center at KU, whether it's a noxious weed in the state of Kansas. They said what we send you is not. So
I just didn't know if we planted it somewhere where the neighbors would not be too receptive to having that next.
Well, milkweed is a broadleaf weed, so you wouldn't want to spray it because that would kill it. And that's what's happened to the monarch population over the years. Apparently there's been so much spraying going on, there is no more milkweed, there's no place to habitat for monarch butterflies.
So is this one of those things where you're better off planting strips here and there and everywhere rather than a big broad area?
In this information, and Deb can probably get the same information for you, they've planted in patches. Then you, around these patches, you put in your nectar-bearing plants.
How big a patch are they recommending?
They said apparently no size, anywhere from 4 foot across up to an acre.
I wondered about some of the ponding areas and things down here where it's no native grasses and plants anyway, and there's not a lot of neighbors to be bothered by it.
Yeah, we were thinking about
have all of that.
Right. Well, we were thinking more like right where your finger, right there.
Yeah, ponding area.
As long as that neighborhood is, you know, that neighborhood is, would that be a good place or?
It'll flood. Trains in mind.
I would suggest if you were going to call these people to see if they still have plants available. Okay. They sent them out prior to planting time. And the planting time in this latitude is May the 15th. So you're going to have to work pretty quickly on this.
Do you have contact information for that, for them?
It's a lady named Dena. D-E-N-A, and it's Kowalski or some kind of Austrian name of some sort. But you get on the website, monarchwatch.org. And I could give you their phone number, too.
Well, how do you guys feel about this?
I'm for it.
I think we've got a lot of, especially if we look at areas like that where I don't think there's going to be much area to be bothered, and I know that the monarchs have really taken a hit.
Straits, yeah.
Well, this is a freebie for this city to do. Well, if you need some funding, then I would look at the Convention and Tourism Bureau, because if you could establish this is a waypoint for monarch butterflies, I can't verify this, but you might have some people coming in to visit the waypoint. So you might get some tourist benefit out of it, too.
How do you guys feel about it?
I think it'd be great.
Yeah.
And as far as getting them planted, how do you guys feel?
Well, does the cemetery, or do you have a cedar machine?
No, I think we do.
No.
We just have broadcasts.
I mean, have stuff to spreadsheet.
What I'm going to do in my area is take a spade, and my wife and I will go out, and we will take a spade and jam it in the ground, raise it up, and that will make me a little furrow. Then I'll put my plants in there and step it down and heal it in.
This is pretty labor intensive.
But if we got FFA and kids to help them.
Does the cemetery have an aerator?
No, we don't.
You know what an aerator is?
Yeah, I know what an aerator, we don't have one.
Holes in the ground?
Nope, we don't have one.
I know somebody who does though.
So do I.
We sure we could borrow.
If you could put, along a fence line, if you could put a four inch, a 4 foot width of aerator, just sprinkle seeds up there.
Are you thinking Wayne?
No.
No? You know someone else? Okay.
We can also ask the extension agency, this would be something they'd be interested in. Anastasia would probably be really interested in this.
I did not visit with her. I visited with Craig Zerger up there, or Craig.
Lister.
Lister. And he said it might be a project that their whole class would undertake for the city.
Yeah, it'd be educational for them.
Well, it's free health.
Yeah, they gotta get going, school will be out soon.
Yeah.
Well, the other thing is if it's supposed to be planted by May 15th, we don't have a lot of time.
Right.
If you get on their website and you punch in, everything is done, it's not done mechanically by letter or telephone. You have to website it. And you just, the first thing you're going to find out from them is if you're on the migratory path.
I thought you said we already did.
Yeah, but the first thing they're going to
I've seen them by the hundreds come to my folks' yard, just cover the bark of the trees. You couldn't even see a tree underneath it. And you, this time of year, you can't look anywhere without seeing monarchs. We are on the path.
So what we have is we'd have to...
Well, you have to be on the path for them to give you free plants. They know what they consider the path. When I called her, and she said, well, where are you at? And I said, I'm Franklin Township 3128. That's the description of my farm. Okay, you're right in the middle of the path. So I just wanted to share this with you. It might be something for
That's
the
great.
City to think about, because it would be, I think it'd be an attractive addition to the community.
Well, you guys want to jump through the hoops to get this to happen this year, or you want to wait and work on it next year, let him do the first year and see what happens, or?
Well, we can see if it's still possible for this year. We don't know that it might be too late to get the seeds or the pods.
And it would have to be somewhere where we don't mow.
Well, they have directions on mowing
or
and stuff
spraying.
Here too.
We don't have to
mowing and burning and fertilizing and all that. I think the main thing is just get them in the ground.
Also. Did they send that information to you, Jim, or did you have to go online and research?
I went online to get this.
It wouldn't be too hard to
12 pages of information. A lot of information.
Maybe we should get a copy.
That's what I'm thinking.
Maybe we should get a copy of what he has.
What'd you say, Kevin?
I said just keep it towards the outside edge of the levee out there. So
first
10 or 15 feet or something like that.
Committees, or what would you want to do?
Well, I don't want everybody to be reading all the documents right now. That would take way too long. So we just kind of need to know how, if we want to go ahead and proceed and have Austin do it, take care of it, or... Really, we just have to see if we're in the path to get the free milkweed, and two, if we can still get the free milkweed, and then if you want him to go ahead and buy the nectar-bearing plant seeds and contact someone with a, what do you call it?
Aerator.
Aerator. That's the thing that pumps up.
Well, perhaps the horticulturist lady, I'm not... familiar with her. I don't know how.
Well, actually, all that would be under your spending limit. So we could just direct him if it's possible to go ahead.
I got some ideas. I got some ideas.
Yeah. Okay. Well, thanks, Jim.
I'd at least try part of it this year. If it works, then
if we can get the seeds, I'll make sure we can get the seeds or the plants.
You want to run copies of this off, Austin?
I could. Yeah, I can do that.
Thanks, Jim.
Yeah.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, Jim.
Thank you.
We'll have those back for my record.
I will get them back.
Thanks, Jim. All right, well, we'll move ahead. The next item is the Garden Club donation. Annie, are you here to share, or Diane, are you here to share, or is it just the information in the packet?
Just the information.
Okay, so they provided on pages 9 to 13 what they spent in the area, which is what we requested. And now they're requesting another $500 donation.
That's their annual donation, right?
What now? That's their annual amount.
I'll make a motion to donate $500 to the Garden Club.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? 7-0. All right. The Nemaha Marshall Agreement on well number 12 is on pages 14 to 18.
Thank you. Call me if you need any of it.
Thank you. Austin, did you have Craig look at this?
I read through this. It's basically Nemaha Marshall's telling us that with the three-phase line that they would put in, that we would be the sole receivers of that. We can't sublet it out. They would have to be the authorizing entity to give it to anybody else. If anybody else wants to hook on to it, they must go through Nemaha Marshall. I mean, they're telling us that this is their line. They are providing us with three-phase and a standard. We're not liable if the power goes off, sort of thing. And then it's an agreement. If we were going to make payments, which we're not going to make payments, we're going to pay it all up front. It just has sort of a five-year agreement to it on how those payments would play out. But since we're not making payments, we're paying it all up front. They're giving us a discount on the estimate from the initial $36,000. I think it's $33,431.68. And that is still an estimate. It could go a little up. They're thinking they did it on the high side, so more than likely it could go down, even from that.
No, it's a lot of money, but the membership fees, that's a real joke. It's just part of it.
Yeah.
I didn't know if it was per service or, you know.
Okay. It's a new three-phase line. I think this is a boilerplate agreement.
Okay.
Where they filled in the numbers, and I couldn't find anything that's out of line.
Entertain a motion?
Move to have the mayor sign the agreement form for Nemaha.
Second.
Marshall Electric.
Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? 7-0. All right. The next item is the consent agenda. There are five items listed for convention and tourism.
Move to approve the consent agenda.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? 7-0. The next item is the appropriations ordinance.
I'll move that appropriations ordinance number 3649 be approved.
Second it.
Is there any discussion?
One thing I might mention is probably our citizens don't realize we pay property tax. And one of the items in this is our last half of property tax. We pay property tax of $12,341. A year, probably about half of that is on the Kester block, and the rest on our various properties that we own.
What are we paying on besides the Kester block?
Anything we make money off of, do
it. Yeah, it shows in there, and
quite a number of lots.
Mm-hmm. Lots? Yeah. Not the ones that, not the buyout lots.
I don't know what they are.
Because of buyout lots, we only make a dollar, so we never want to do it for
property. Yeah.
So, who has the box? Does it state what it is?
Yes.
Besides Kester Block?
Mm-hmm.
Just humor me and tell me what it is besides the Kester Block.
I'll let you look it up since you know.
Okay, there's 904 Walnut, there's Lot 1, Lot 21, which is by Bucks Motor.
We filed an appeal on the 904, that was just
Was that the Boy Scout cabin? What's 904? No, 909.
Down here.
Walnut.
Police Department. That one shouldn't show for the second.
Is that
Does that show for the second half?
Yes, it does.
904.
904 Walnut does not.
Okay.
Do you feel that I'll have an appeal for that? And what else is on there?
Okay, undeveloped streets and alleys, undeveloped 12th Street south of Jayhawk, undeveloped streets and alleys again, that's community garden, lots 10 and 11, lot 69, that's on Oak Street, lots 2, 4, block 69, Spring Street, Kester Block, undeveloped streets and alleys, Jackson Streets, also South 13th Street, also North Street between Land O'Lions Park, Lot 1, 2, Block 74, land acquired next to Bruce's, 11, 12, Block 74, land acquired 12, 15, Cooksey, Lots 1.
Are those the lots on 7th Street?
And we didn't Lot 2, Caboose.
And we didn't try to get those off the tax rolls?
Lots 11, 12, next to Cromie's, lots 10, 11, 12, West R South, industrial lot, and industrial lot, the total on that is $4,649 for the industrial
That's
lots.
The one we get reimbursed back?
Some of it.
Okay.
And then there's a lot 11 on Jackson Street and a lot 12 on Jackson Street.
Those are all buyout lots on Jackson, aren't they?
Why don't you, thank you for bringing that to our attention. Why don't you make sure that all those should be on there for the next time? Just go through them because I'm kind of surprised. All the ones that are undeveloped alleys and streets we pay.
Mm-hmm. It's got to be a specific purpose for them to exempt them.
Okay, but the other ones, if they're like on the 7th Street rail bed, those I think we should get on the tax exempt, don't you? We just have to file the form?
If they're on 7th Street, if they have a purpose that we're using them for.
I thought it had to be that they had to generate revenue.
No, that's only...
That's the Kester Block.
It's if you take a, for instance, if you take one of our buildings, turn it from a general purpose use for the city and turn it into a revenue-making property. For instance, the Kester Block.
Kester Block, yeah.
That could be, we could open that up to the public and let them have a recreation area in the Old Masonic Temple up there and do all that stuff and it'd be tax exempt. But they're making money off of it, so it's not.
Okay, so just go through that list and just make sure there's no way we can reduce that tax bill for the next, for 2018. Thanks for pointing that out, Darlene. Anyone else have any comments regarding the appropriations ordinance?
Mary. Mayor, page 26, Kansas water fee, water protection, clean drink fees, first quarter of 2017, $1,241.49. Why is that so high? What do we get for that? Do they come out here and go through our water, our wells?
Or those are water rights. Am I confused?
Water protection.
Is that their water rights for the wells?
Yeah, it's got something to do with that. You can look at
rights. It's clean drinking fees. It says quarterly. Fees.
It's like the sales tax. You have no choice.
Mm-hmm. No choice? No negotiating?
Nope.
It's just
pay state taking
state
money.
Mandated. They use it for our, in case they have to clean up water somewhere or something goes.
It's not water rights.
No. It doesn't sound right to me.
But it's mandated.
All right. Everybody. Mandated by the state. Thank you.
That's something I know.
Good.
Nothing. Thinking about the button.
Okay. So anything else? I would entertain a motion.
We have a motion.
We have a motion in a second. I'm sorry. Roll call, please.
Biesinger?
Yes.
Boss?
Yes.
Ekis?
Yes.
Fry?
Yes.
Gross?
Yes.
Trolla?
Yes.
Throm?
Yes.
7-0.
All right. Thank you very much. Thank you for auditing those. Austin, you're up.
All right, first up is the CIPP bid. We bid that for a second time because we rejected the last time. This time, I sent it out to three providers, SAK, In-Situ Form, and Lane Inliner. And I only got one bid back, and that bid was lower than any of the other bids we got previously, so that was good for us. So the overall bid for all the communities still involved was $156,529.80, and that's for the entire project. And then for just Marysville, it's $86,428.50.
Did Agenda ask to get pulled out?
Well, they had stated after the last one they weren't even willing to pay $13,000. So that automatically, everybody else was saying $23,000 to $30,000 for their project alone.
Okay.
So that pretty much took them out.
All right. So we would just be accepting In-Situ Forms.
Move to approve the board from In-Situ Form for the CIPP in the amount of $86,428.50.
Second.
Accept the whole.
Want the whole bid?
We accept the whole bid, okay. And then, or accept In-Situ Form the complete project.
The complete project,
yeah.
Okay.
And then everybody else will accept or decline off of us.
How we did last time?
I'm not sure, but I think I would feel.
Could you finish your motion?
I would just accept In-Situ Form. Yeah.
Accept the constituents form for $156,529.80.
Second.
And what's that coming out of? What fund is that coming out of?
That comes.
Is that coming? Oh, it should be on this.
We took it out of last year. We took it out of the revenue fund, yeah. But this year I think we were looking at taking it out of the. The reserve for sewer because it kind of hit, but either or.
Here it is, CIPP replacement fund.
There you go.
And we had an estimated 85,000, so this is just a little bit more. Okay.
So, pardon me, Mayor, are we taking it out of replacement this year?
Yes.
All of it out of replacement.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Okay.
Discussion.
Yes.
Just have we used a different vendor every year, or have we used them
I think
before?
We've used these guys before.
Okay.
And Kent was pretty happy okay. with these guys.
What was that? 2 years ago we used.
Yeah,
them?
We used them.
Midlands was last year,
and I think the year before.
Okay.
And then In-Situ Form was the year before that.
I'm still trying to process this. So we accepted the entire bid, even though our portion is only 86,000, because we can't really commit anyone else to their portion.
Right. And our bid document states that we accept the overall lowest bidder, or for actually the lowest bidder this time around is for City of Marysville. But since there's only one, then our documents say that each city can decline their portion of it, then that won't affect any of our stuff. So however you want to state accepting the lowest bid, that's for Marysville.
If the others decline, we're not on the hook for that whole $156,000.
We're not. I mean, you can say accept the lowest bid or accept, and in which our portion is 86.
Why don't we stipulate that in the bid? Who made the bid?
I did.
When you say stipulating that Marysville's portion is 86.
Yeah. Stipulating that Marysville project cost is $86,428.50.
And coming out of the replacement fund?
Coming out of the replacement fund.
Who was the second?
I second. Yeah.
Okay. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? 7-0. Thank you very much. Sorry about that.
And next up, airport apron. We've been cleared to bid our project, and all we need to do tonight is approve the plans, which have gone through our committee and back through the engineer, and now you have the chance to look at them. So approve these plans, and then approve us to advertise this week for the bid, which should be, the bid opening should be May 17th.
Move to approve the plans and specifications for the airport apron from Olson and Associates, and to do the advertising for the bid openings on May 17th.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? 7-0. All right.
Next up is the capital improvement projects. There, as I was discussing with the mayor, there are some missing ones for this year, but I tried to update the whole list, and really it's, if you noticed anything off yourself, I'd like to know about it. But I tried to incorporate all your projects that we talked about this at the workshop.
So the three that he's going to add to the street department is 19th and Carolina, all for 2017 is 19th and Carolina, 11th Road North, as well as North Street, and the bump outs on 364. And then also I let Kent Bergman talked about that we should get in a rotation of cleaning the water tank on the inside and out, and we need to put that in there somewhere. So those were the four things.
It's inspection and cleaning.
Yeah.
Did you have anything else when you looked at that list that doesn't look like it's on there?
The one thing we had talked about, Parks and Rec, you know, things at the ball field. But I know that's, we haven't determined what those are yet, so.
Yeah. Actually, we should have Feld Field in there for this year, though.
Feld Field, and you might as well put down Lakeview, too, for that parking lot leveling.
Landscape, yeah.
This year? Is it this year?
Is it Lakeview leveling? I'm sorry, have we actually discussed that this for 2017? No? But is it something you think that has to be done in 2017?
No.
So are you?
We just need to get to it one of these days to
so
get
put
that
it in
water
in 2018?
From coming across that ballpark into it.
And we're going to be okay with water for 2017? Or do we need to find a place for it?
You're going to have to build that parking lot up somehow to get that water to go north.
I thought we had somebody that was going to give us a bid on it.
We never had anybody come back through on that.
I think we talked about it, but I don't think we ever really discussed going out for bid.
No.
Well, one guy was going to give us a bid, wasn't he?
Yeah.
We didn't ask him for a bid, but he was going to give us a bid.
Give us an estimate of what he thought it would cost.
And he just never came back.
Yeah, they've been so busy, those.
So... is it something you want to do, you guys feel like you want to do that in 2017 or push it to 2018? We have a lot of expenditures in 2018, FYI, when you look at those totals there. So I don't know if you want to try to push that to 2017 or not.
Let me talk to him and see what we can come up with on it.
Is that all right? Okay, just to get a general estimate
before
we go out for bid?
Yeah.
You're going to tell them we want just a general
estimate?
Just a general estimate.
Not a bid. Yeah,
okay.
It's not a bid.
All right.
I'll get all that updated. All right. The next one is also for your information. You guys asked us for a priority list of streets. And Gary had this from 2 years ago, and actually the pictures are from recently. He went out and took them this year. And this is all information for what we look at as far as what we do with streets. Now you'll see some in the maps that may have already been updated. As far as they've been fixed or they're in better condition, they've been chip and sealed. That's because the maps are still from 2 years ago, but we tried to upgrade the streets themselves. So that's,
did he update these lists for what he knows is done?
I think these are still 2015.
Yes, okay.
Yeah. So some of that might be upgraded. But probably most of it has not.
Okay. He did put 2016 on here, though. Did he just do these maps?
No, he's had a lot of that information from 2 years ago.
Even though it says 2016 on it?
Let me look. 2016 asphalt street conditions. That might have been the end. He said these took months to do.
So, I believe that.
Yeah.
So, I didn't really remember these existing, this detail. But as I look at these maps, I told Austin we need to have a plan because we can't just watch the red, which is the ones in bad condition, get worse and worse and worse. we need to kind of have a plan, what we think we can do in-house and what we need to contract out. And we need to go ahead and build that into our budget that we just looked at. Because we have possibly doing 11th Road South and Keystone, but we don't have any other major street repairs in those plans.
Could I suggest maybe we have him update these with what's been done and then resort the list based on the surface type and the prior, so put all the ones together.
Well, these maps, did you get these?
Yeah, I did, but I mean, just in terms of the list, so you can just go down the list and say, here's the number one, you know, here's what he referred to as beyond, well, just rank them one through five, and but by surface type, so you can at least kind of look, because you can go down the list and pick it out, but it might be easier just to...
Well, I kind of like these more than that list, because it's kind of, you just kind of look at it.
Well, I mean, there's no real, I mean, you can prioritize, but in reality, it's just, you got bad curb, you got good curb, and the best we can do is, if we have projects in this area, we try to get them all, because that makes it much cheaper on the concrete.
So when I look like at the asphalt one, you know, the red streets, Austin said we would not want to redo an asphalt street that we just chip and sealed. So we need to coordinate the chip and seal program with the red streets and work on those and not chip and seal them in 2018. You know what I'm saying?
But some of our asphalt streets are so badly deteriorated, we need to actually have them come in, ground out, and a new 2 or 3 inch overlay put on them.
And that's what we would have to do on the red. And so the key thing is to figure out which of these red are the oldest chip and seal streets. This is how I would approach. The old, preferably the ones we would do in 2018, maybe, and see which of those we would prefer to do mill and overlay rather than chip and seal in 2018. Does that make sense to you guys? Mm-hmm. And that way, because we're not going to do anything different for 2017, mm-hmm. and then plan, and did, is this asphalt one that we were estimating cost, or was that...
We were trying, because we were trying to go off of the clink mill and overlay. But
that was what we're doing. Okay,
but it's hard to tell.
Why don't you have we had just streets done recently on mill and overlay other than clink? So. Okay.
Not to my knowledge.
Okay. Well,
have you driven all these streets?
Not
all red.
Not all of them.
Some of them aren't right.
Some of them are what?
Aren't right.
Are not correct.
Yeah, right behind Casey's, it's red. 3/4 of that's been replaced.
Yeah, no, that's what I'm saying. This is old information. We're going to get it updated.
Okay.
Yeah.
So maybe you can, I think maybe propose here for 2018 what you think we need to do, and maybe 2019 the two choices based on our chip and seal routes and what has been done.
Mm-hmm.
So that I just think we can't just keep chip and seal is not going to be sufficient year after year after year. We're going to have to bite the bullet and do a mill and overlay. So we might as well just pick those out. And then the next page of gravel, we didn't have any bad, so I said, phew, we'll skip that one. And the brick one, you know, when I talked to Austin, I mean, we know. Austin's convinced that we need to buy a brick laying machine, but until that happens, he just wants to fly to Germany, let's be honest. But until that happens, you know, when I look at this map of the brick intersections, I would like us to work, our street crew to work on intersections. I mean, they did a really good job. They can't do whole streets, or I shouldn't say we shouldn't devote their time to whole streets, but some of these intersections, like up there by Dargis Park, and some just the ones where the dots are right in the intersections, I'm thinking we should have Gary plan how many of those he can do, work into a summer between chip and seal, and have a schedule for him. And that's why, as far as the, you know, there's two big streets, 11th and 12th, I don't know what to say about those. And have but the intersections, I think we can make
what additional time some of the intersections.
How do you guys feel about that? And tell us how much extra time we have. And just kind of aim towards these intersections. And he can, I didn't drive by these intersections to make sure they're a problem, but I'm sure the brick is still a problem. They haven't done anything to those.
Mm-hmm.
So see what he says about that. And then the last one is the cement, and it's kind of, it looks like, you know, this 8th Street looks like a major, the major one. And again, I think we need to figure out how to, those, we talked about our crew doing cement, but we didn't feel like they should do more than a block, right, Austin?
Somewhere in there, just, it's a challenge to, it's not that they can't do it, but it's what's going to come up when they're doing it.
We get called off of off the task too much.
Yeah, right.
So we were thinking if it's a block or less, mm-hmm. our guys could probably do it. If again, fitting into their schedule, but that long one, I guess we need to figure out in the next 5 years when we're going to do North 8th Street.
The one there at the on 12th Street by the school seems like it should be kind of a priority too, since it gets a lot of traffic and foot traffic, mm-hmm. and it's on a curve, and it is a block.
Are you talking by the high school?
Yeah, there, okay. The one above the football field there, because that is, it's been patched with cold mix in the cracks, but it is breaking up really bad.
That curve is bad.
Yeah. And it's kind of good that they're going to be done with the construction and then to do it, because you wouldn't want all the heavy.
You wouldn't have wanted to do it before and then have them drive all over
it. Well, they would definitely have to do that during the summer. They would have definitely have to do that during the summer months.
Right. So parking is such a premium anyway.
I would like the head of them doing it in 2017. None?
I don't know about that.
It's this one right there.
It'd be a challenge.
Well, why don't you ask Gary how much time he thinks his crew would have to do any brick intersections and any one block areas of cement, and then we'll have to go from there. And as far as that 8th Street, do we want to go ahead and tell Austin or ask Austin to put it on the long-term plan for a certain year? I mean, we need to bite the bullet sometime.
It's a thoroughfare.
That's right. And going back to our expenditures, let's see where we're at. Pick a year. Oh man. Well, 2019 is contingent on us doing that north or south 11th road. That's 1.5 million of that. You know, maybe we should do it in 2018 if we don't. If we don't do that, the CLINK project or CCLIP, or what's it called?
CCLIP, yeah.
CCLIP for Highway 77. If that we don't get that grant money, maybe we should go ahead and do it in 18. Do you want to have them put it in 18 for now?
Yeah, that'd be good.
You can stick it there.
Yeah.
So that would be 8th Street. And at least we get the long section done. So anyway, you want to bring it back? Tell us what he thinks he can and can't do, and then we can plan out the rest. But thank you for doing that, bringing it to us.
Great. Next one on the list is sales tax roll forward. It's just an estimate on the breakdown of our sales tax fund expenditures and an estimate on how much we're going to get in sales tax, as well as reimbursements for grants. It kind of shows basically month by month from March to December what's going to happen, what I think is going to happen, and how much money is going to be in the fund at that point in time. And the mayor asked me to do this to see if we would be able to take on the whole of the, because we're paying for the whole of the CLINK project up front, and then they're reimbursing us, and that's a $600,000 expenditure. According to my estimates, we are going to be able to take that, and it will reach down to about $400,000 after the CLINK project, and then they'll give us $300,000. And then we also have the crosswalk project in there, which I estimated us paying for the full project as well, and then them reimbursing us for that worst-case scenario. And it all seemed to play out, and I kind of made some estimates on the expenditures, where it just says expenditures up top. That's normal stuff that comes out. I estimated $40,000 that first month of March. That is what actually came out of what actually went in and came out of the sales tax fund in that month. So that's just a breakdown of what could happen over this year.
Yeah, the $50,000 that he estimated per month, you know, we have about $29,000 committed every month to the general fund. So he has an extra $20,000 cushion in there. And then from the revenue side, we talked about, he initially thought it would be conservatively low. Mm-hmm. And I did pull this last time, and Austin said that this month just came in and it was at...
It came in at $69,500 and some dollars. So it hit my hit below my low estimate, but I don't think it's going to hang down there for the whole
year.
Yeah,
something we need to remember is that, you know, sales tax will fluctuate rather than property taxes. In our April last year, we got almost $79,000, so that's a $10,000 swing. I mean, it still won't put us in a bad, bad situation, but it's, I guess we have to keep an eye on that. And then when he was doing this, he had an August that we paid for the clink, and then he had the reimbursement in September, and we don't know how fast they reimburse that. So I said, what's our worst case scenario? And in August, he had 408. And let's say we don't get the 300 back for a couple months, and then we go ahead and have the crosswalk project, it will bring it down to 275, which we would still be okay. So that's worst case scenario, mm-hmm. based on funding both of those projects with cash. Right. So. Oh, and the other thing, in May he didn't have the failed field in there because we're buying that. Do you want to tell them, or we don't want to talk about that failed field right now, about the listserv?
Oh, that's not a big deal. We actually, today, out of all days, we got a request came over the city clerk's listserv looking for bleachers and a scoreboard?
No, we just threw that in.
Oh, okay. They were looking for bleachers.
Would you like a scoreboard?
Yeah, and so Debbie asked them if they wanted a scoreboard as well.
So we might be able to sell it.
We might be able to sell it.
Rather than just trying to disassemble it.
I want an old dump truck too.
Disassemble it.
But no, so we might get a little bit of money for the bleachers and the scoreboard that they are replacing. Probably a little bit more than we would get scrapping the metal.
We would still have to disassemble it. So do we have volunteers to do that? I don't think
we have volunteers.
Do we have any volunteers yet?
I haven't heard of anybody wanting to sign up yet.
And yeah. Dave hasn't said anything. So May, everybody be prepared to bring your wrenches and we will disassemble it then.
Don't we have a bunch put back for that clink project already though?
No, we don't have it. That was the geometric improvement project.
Oh.
That we put that cash in the capital improvements fund, but we haven't put any cash aside out of the sales tax fund this year.
No.
But it gave me peace of mind when he prepared that schedule that we were going to be, worst case scenario, we'd still be okay with our cash flow for sales tax for this year.
Right. But looking at this, we will, if we get the pavement reconstruction on the Highway 77, we will have to look at different funding options as far as possibly going and getting some more debt.
Because it's a $1.6 million and we have to upfront that and reimburse it as well, so.
Actually, I'm not sure on how that funding structure is.
Oh, you don't think it's a reimbursement?
It's a new program. I don't know. It's up to $1 million. I don't know if they're going to do drawdown or make us pay it all up front.
We want them to do drawdown. Okay, and do you want to go ahead and talk about your surplus, or is there anything else?
The only thing I have left is the surplus vehicles. I didn't get this list in time for the packet, but I have a list of vehicles. The 2003 F-550, the number 4000, the one that we replaced, that died,
We took the bed off of.
Yeah, we took the bed off of.
So now we're just going to sell the, what's left?
Sell what's left. And then
bones.
That's number 4,000. And then 1984 International Dump Truck with a blade, and that's number 516. 1986 International Dump Truck number with a blade as well, number 523. And then 1970 Chevy cab and chassis that has a bad motor, number 607. And then three loader tires.
So if you guys are okay with that, can we, someone make that motion?
Move to approve the surplus list as noted.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? 7-0. Thank you very much. Is there anything else?
Not from me.
All right. Debbie, do you have anything?
Nothing tonight. Thank you.
All right. Standing committee reports. First thing is street. When I was at the mayoral summit, I talked to one of the mayors from Inman, and he said that he uses a slurry seal rather than chip and seal because it doesn't create the dust. So I asked Austin to look into that. He also said that it didn't crack as much as chip and seal. So we'll see. He'll investigate and see if the costs are the same or see the impact of that. Also, I was talking to that gentleman, and he said his street sweeper was 30 years old. So I'm going to have Austin talk to him about how come his street sweeper is 30 years old. And the last thing is, and I'm going to ask Debbie to do a listserv on this, but he says that their county subsidizes their road repairs. And I asked him at what extent, and he said $100,000 a year. That the county subsidizes this.
What county is it?
It's Inman. So we, yeah.
McPherson.
So I thought, I was going to ask Debbie to do a listserv to see if this is going on lots of places or if this is an isolated situation. Mm-hmm. So you'll do that. And if it's common, I guess we have to make things with our county commissioner.
Where's that at?
Inman?
McPherson. McPherson County.
Yeah, that would be why.
That would be what?
They have refineries there, don't they?
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, he claims he has the best streets of any small town in Kansas.
Those refineries pay a lot of taxes, a lot of property taxes, just like having an energy center.
Well, I just thought we should find out if other street cities get it. It's worth a listserv anyway, so kind of interesting. Anybody else have streets?
I do. I would like to discuss again the 8th Street in Ann and put in a stop sign there. Evidently, there was a police committee or a street committee or something went on, and it was decided to do nothing there. And I'd like someone, I must have missed this.
It wasn't decided to do nothing. It was decided we didn't have a proposal to bring to the council for it, which isn't the same as doing nothing. The committees can't make decisions on their own. It was just the committee discussed it, and the decision was we should consider other alternative options, probably in further discussion. That was there.
A further discussion. Well, alternatives such as what?
Well, it's funny. I got an email from that constituent, and she was talking about that we need to put down speed deterring surfaces, and that's the street that we're thinking about improving. So that seems like that would make the street faster if it, you know. That 8th Street from Calhoun to North Street is our red area.
Put in a brick street.
But yeah, but Ann's north of there, and that's the
one
better
block,
section of the street.
One yep. block, yeah. Yep. But I'm just saying, they're going to have their, if you have a brand new surface, if we put a brand new concrete in there.
Right. Well, to recap the concerns of the committee, there's a lot of on-street parking there because mm-hmm. the houses don't have any off-street parking, mm-hmm. And it's kind of congested as is. And the concern was, and there's a downhill section off of Ann, but, and it's technically mm-hmm. a four-way intersection, but the concern was it would actually create increased hazard to put a stop sign there, and we'd have to remove parking enough that it would cause other problems down the line. That's why we decided maybe we'd look at other alternatives that wouldn't displace people and create a hazard.
What alternatives? What else can you do? What, lower the speed limit to 20?
Put a stop sign possible. This was just an idea. This is not proposed. but just put a stop sign at like North and 8th or something like that, where you would slow them down farther down the road rather than at 8th and Ann. Because there's not a lot of parking right in the corner at 8th and North.
8th and Ann.
Right. There isn't at 8th and North, but there is at 8th and Ann.
So there's already a stop sign going east and west there, right? So you're going to make that a four-way stop?
That would be an idea. It was one of those where we thought we'd talk to some people who either live in the area and transit that way regularly and kind of revisit it, continue the conversation.
The question was whether anybody else really thought it was a problem.
Right.
It has been, it's been there forever. We haven't had a stop sign there, but we are doing a development out there. Hartley Ridge is out there, and we are proposing the walking trail, which I understand that land has been purchased to move that off of 8th Street over onto the rail bed. The
old levee.
The old levee.
Is it purchased?
I think they're still in the process.
I don't think you can say it's purchased yet.
Okay, well, the whole idea is that it's not going to be forever on 8th Street, but there's not continuous sidewalks up there. And I've been up there visiting when, here comes a lady with a toddler by her side and pushing a baby buggy and on-street parking, and she's having to weave out. And believe me, to single her out, if you're the driver of a vehicle, to single her out with all the parking, the cars parked there, it's difficult to see, pedestrians or a bicyclist. So I'm just saying that we have an issue there that somehow or other we need to address it.
Yeah, but it sounds like we have to allow parking on that street because...
That was kind of a big concern because a lot of those houses don't have off-street parking, and it is very parked a lot. You drive up there, you actually have difficulty finding
cars.
A spot.
Always cars there. And when you stop at the sign at Ann Street, it is hard to figure out you got to sit there a minute to figure out that those cars are parked. They're going nowhere. Mm-hmm. So if you have somebody parked on this side and you have two or three cars parked this way and you're going west at Ann and you're going to turn south on 8th Street, that's a rough turn.
Is there a stop sign at Ann?
Yes.
Yeah. 8th going
both
west,
directions, west and east.
East and west.
Right. But the whole thing was the speed of the traffic goes north and south. And my concern or my thought at alleviating the problem is to have our police officers enforce the speed limit as it is now. And since we're not changing it, to give out tickets, to start writing tickets there at that intersection.
The funny thing is, though, you watch somebody even going 30, looks like they're flying since it's such a ton.
You can't go over 30 on that road. Well, I know it looks
really fast.
But you cannot, once you go down the hill and come up, you can't go 30 when you're going by that house. I know 30 seems like they're really going.
Well, it really would be if you were a pedestrian and you're squeezed into no sidewalk here, car parked against a curb here, car parked against a curb here, and no sidewalk here. You have to pull out. You have to walk out into the traffic. And I think it's an issue that somehow we need to find some solution.
Okay. Well, street committee's still working on it, right?
The police and fire.
Police and fire.
And another street issue. We've got the Big Blue Barbecue coming up, and I've been approached a couple times by people who live in the apartments downtown. Not only just the over and above, but the ones like across from the Hellring Center on 8th Street at Elm. Those spaces are all taken up. If they go to the grocery store or if they, they can't get back home, there's no place for them to park. And we have a lot of elderly or senior citizens that live there. I was just thinking how we could block parking off for them. Maybe it's a matter of education, reminding them when this is going to happen. If you need to go get groceries, go get them, because if you give up your parking space during this time, you're not going to get it back. And you'd be lucky to find a place down at the park and have to schlep your groceries back up home.
Is Sleepy Onyx going to be open on Saturdays? Sleepy Onyx?
Does anybody know?
I just saw that they were reopening. Did I read that?
I don't think he was ever open on Saturday before. I don't know why they'd be open on Saturday now.
I wonder if there's any way we could speak with him and ask him if he'd let us.
They park
on private property.
They park in there anyway.
They park.
People park in there. Napa over here too, the same way. I had the store for 10 years, and they parked that thing full. And we were open till noon.
Well, I don't know how to do it, but just think if you were trying, you live there, and you make, you know, you go out to get groceries.
It's only for a couple of days. I mean, they can get their groceries early if they
have to. Well, that's what I'm saying. Maybe to inform the landlord or put notices out on their doors, something special that reminds them, you know, you got to get your groceries and get back home because you're going to lose your parking spot. I just don't see a way that we can mark them off. I mean, that was the recommendation.
But they should become aware of it on Friday when there's, they drag main on Friday. That's when they have the
cruise night.
The cruise night. So it seems like that should be a hint that the next day's the barbecue.
They go home, they sit in the house and watch the TV. I mean, I missed the prom walk, for heaven's sakes, because I just wasn't paying attention. And I don't know if they, you know, if they got to think about it a couple of days ahead of time. If they've waited until Friday night, they're going to lose their parking spot.
Why don't you go out in like the newsletter, something like that, a little note, just a reminder that this is going on and
the
parking
newsletter?
Will be tight.
The newsletter already got that.
Or if we could talk to the landlord. I mean, that's of that one building.
Thanks so much, man.
Ooh, is it? Help me.
Shooty.
Bud Shooty.
Yeah, Bud Shooty. If he would inform his residents.
Well, Debbie can do that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Anybody else?
I'm trying to think of anybody else that, some place that has multi-residents there, renters that put their
downtown.
Yeah. Maybe up above Jeter's, there's several people that live there that might want to be informed and just say, oh yeah, I need to have my groceries and stuff and, you know, everything, my car filled with gas or whatever by Thursday, because Friday, Saturday, Sunday, I move my car, I lose my spot, I have to park down south of town.
Okay, well, we can at least contact those two landlords.
Right.
Okay.
Well, thank you.
All right. Water, wastewater, Parks Rec.
Are we doing anything about Arbor Day?
When were they were planning something.
I haven't heard from anybody.
Okay.
Because we can have our, for Tree City, we can have our Arbor Day celebration.
I thought we planted that tree for Arbor Day.
That was October last year.
That was last year's Arbor Day? Oh. Okay. I'm a little behind. So we just need to think of something for this year. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Darlene. Cemetery and Airport. Police and Fire. Admin and Finance. The one thing I thought that we should probably give Austin a little direction on was, you know, he's working on the budget right now. And I think that when he presents, when we have our next meeting, he's going to actually present a budget. So I thought we should at least have a discussion on what we want to see in the budget. Like, I would like to see the mill levy stay flat. That's my direction I would give to him. You guys think that's impossible? You think that's a good plan? I think with the new, there's been a lot of increased valuations, and there's been, with the school bond increase, I think we'll be serving our residents well if we keep it flat, if it's possible.
Possible.
So is that okay? Just give him that guide, and you can see how close you come?
Mm-hmm.
Fair enough?
That's usually the goal.
Okay. Just wanted to get that out there to you. Anything else? All right. The swimming pool appointments are on page 71.
Move to approve the swimming pool wages for 2017.
Second.
Any discussion?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
How come we have to have an assistant manager when we got two co-managers?
Well, last year we had a manager and three assistant managers, just FYI. And we had, I was talking to Austin about this today. Last year we had 21 guards and we had three assistant managers and a manager.
And not always are these co-managers going to be there, so they have the ability, which is a positive, to leave the assistant manager in charge, and we can only have somebody there getting paid $9 an hour rather than $30.
Co-managers should never be there at the same time.
No, they're not going to be there at the same time. They're going to be, whichever co-manager is going to be there, they'll be there, and then the other one, and then if let's say they planned, they told me in advance, a month in advance, that they couldn't be here on this weekend because now it's a downfall, it's family. They have a vacation or something like that. Now they have an assistant manager that can take charge.
Well, as I'm looking at this too, these admin con and admin con, I see two people that are at the concession stand, and those are, one at least has supervisor pay. Mm-hmm. So we've got four managers right there. And what about the other one? $7.50 per hour, second year. Admin con.
Well, yeah, she was there last year.
Concessions. Concessions.
Admissions concessions.
Admissions concessions.
For consecutive years.
So there's six of those listed on there, and I think Ricky Bikeman is the one that was manager last year, and right. Her pay is slightly higher. I think it's 25 cents higher, or is it 50 cents higher?
50 cents.
50 cents higher because she was the manager last year when I talked to Austin.
But when we're talking about managers, she's considered a manager, right?
The concession stand.
Right.
She doesn't have the qualifications of the lifeguards or anything. She doesn't have that. She's not going to be in charge of the lifeguards.
She wasn't one of the managers I listed before. We had three pool managers and Maria last year.
Wasn't she considered an assistant manager last
year? Not. She wasn't listed as. All right, we had three in that one box. We had three managers.
I see that, yeah.
Assistant managers.
Plus Maria.
Plus Ricky as the admissions concessions manager.
Right. Okay.
So, I'm impressed at the two co-managers, how they've gotten everything together, and they seem to be really on top of everything.
And I was talking to Kent Bergman today, and he made a comment. He goes, they read through the swimming pool manual. Did you read that? And he said that they were amazed on how much responsibility it was. So they're getting prepared. They're ready to go. And I think they say in the highlights that they were going to come this Saturday?
Yep. The 6th. Yeah. Yep.
And Kent said there's water in the pool now. So.
Yeah, it's full.
So it sounds like they're on top of it. That's all to say that.
The bar looks like tonight.
They were filling that thing up, yep.
And Austin, did you say that they are still trying to find some more guards?
Yeah, as we get, we keep getting applications in. We got one the other day. So, we're still looking for them.
So, but we could start with 17, you feel?
Mm-hmm.
Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? 7-0. All right. All right, city attorney, you're up.
Looks like the first thing is 11th Street Improvement District. My understanding is it was discussed at the last council meeting that I wasn't in attendance. And part of that, or a question that arose from that discussion, was properties outside of the city limits, could they be assessed? And there is a statute that applies directly to that question. It's 12-693. In subsection A, the three basic possibilities where that could happen is if a subdivision has been adopted. Don't believe that's not the case here. The city has obtained county's consent, or 100% of the property owners located outside of the city limits have signed a petition requesting that they make improvements, and it has to be within 3 miles of the city line. So it may be that doesn't exist here, and if that's the case, then the city may not be able to assess properties outside of the city limits.
You're saying it has to be related to a subdivision?
That's one of those.
And the second one is what?
The city obtained county's consent, or there's an agreement between the county and the city on that. So it's sort of an interlocal agreement between the two entities. I don't know how possible that is. So I guess at this point, without knowing more information, the answer is it's possible, but it may not be.
And what was the third? I'm sorry.
100% of the property owners located outside the city limits sign a petition requesting.
Oh, sign it, or they would agree to it? They have to request it? Would agreement be?
Well, they have to do that. I mean, they have to sign a petition according to the statute.
So if we would do that, we would 100%. So every single person that lives outside the city limits.
Within 3 miles, is that?
Yeah, it's gotta be within 3 miles of the.
Not just bordering that road.
It doesn't have to necessarily, but if we're just talking about a road improvement, it doesn't have to be the abutting properties, but it does have to be within 3 miles, my reading of that statute. Just like if it was within, which I think was another question previously, could properties that did not abut to the road being improved be assessed? And yes, they could, or they could be part of that district.
So Bulldog Apartments, so that situation is that Bulldog Apartments, who would use 11th Road South, we could assess those.
Could be, yes.
And in this situation, we would have any property that's not in the city limits, 100% of the people would have to agree to it.
That's one way, according to subsection A. So these were ors, one, two, or three.
So not all those properties are on Keystone. Two of them are outside city limits because they own enough ground.
Yeah, see, this we'd have to, it'd be this one and that one. And then we also have that little tiny piece there. If we just did 11th Road South, that whoever owns this little piece right here would have to agree to it.
Who's it?
The Peaks?
I don't know. You guys know much? Is this a property? Is this one property owner?
Yeah.
You guys know this?
Yeah, Marcus
Freeze.
And you guys know this one?
Yeah.
Marcus Freeze.
No.
CJ Grauer, I thought.
Yeah, I thought Grauer owned it. Marcus owns that one too?
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
Well, that's an easy call. Just maybe. Call Marcus and say, is there any way you want pavement in front of that street, right? And if he says no, that kind of gets rid of Keystone.
Gets rid of
or assessment. The assessment, yeah.
Get rid of the assessment.
I don't know how you could pave that and not assess everybody. What do you think? If he says no, would you prefer just to do 11th Road South? Or if he says no to assess just the people inside city limits, that kind of punishes them for being inside city limits.
That would be between them.
I could see still doing 11th Road South.
Well, yeah, well, 11th, you mean rather not this one person agrees, we could waive them if they don't want to do it?
I think they would agree.
They have very small frontage on that road.
40 feet, 60 feet, whatever it is across there. I mean, that's minimal compared to the rest of the property owners through there.
Is this road, sorry for not knowing the answer to this already, but does it lie upon the boundary limit of the city and the county? Is that what we're talking about? One of the roads is the boundary?
The boundary of the township in the city.
Yeah.
It would be a township, okay. Yeah.
Well, that could invoke another subsection in here that talks about that subsection C of this statute. But again, it discusses that the governing body of the city and the board of county commissioners may enter into an agreement whereby the city or county may initiate such improvements. And then it relates back to, the primary statute with improvement districts is 12-6-A-04. Petitions, what they have to include, public hearings on the advisability of the improvement. And that's none of that's happened, right? That has to be done by resolution of the council for an advisability hearing to take place. And that's all governed by that statute. So, I think that's probably the city's next step is to have that sort of a hearing to sift through the boundaries of the improvement district, possibilities of assessment. You can come back to the council. You can go back and forth until the council finally by resolution makes findings, but you have to follow the requirements under this statute, 12-6A04, for that to happen.
So your suggestion is for us to go ahead and have a hearing?
Well, if that's what the governing body wants to do.
Okay, for both roads or just 11th Road, Craig? Because the Keystone Road out there is a boundary line of city-county on those two sections. For 11th Road, everybody is pretty much in city limit bound.
Are we able just to go up and ask Marcus? Would you be willing to pay assessments if we paved that road? Are we able to just go ask that question?
I don't know anything that restricts that. So I don't know that there's a legal answer to that question. That's a different kind of question, I think. But if we are talking about that boundary, and possibly if you're not talking about a road on a boundary, but you are talking about property outside of city limits, you might, it's very possible you're going to have to involve a county, some sort of an agreement.
Well, isn't Keystone from 11th Road to 11th Terrace the city's?
Yeah, well, except those two areas.
No, do we own the road is your question, right?
Yeah. Is it just the road?
Do we owe the road? Like Jayhawk, we had split, and then we took the road. 8th Street, we had the share road, and we took the road.
Are they dedicated roads, or does the property owner own to the center of it like they do in the... You know, if you're out in the township, you own to the center of the road.
So I guess
you don't own to the fence line, you own to the center of the road. So that's what I mean. Is there a dedicated platted road through there on Keystone?
What's the township? And is there a governing body to have it?
There's always a governing body, yeah. Somebody has to keep the records, but
right.
Because they have to determine a budget. For
is it Marysville Township?
That's my first guess. But I'm
yeah, not I think 12th Road is the township line. Mm. So on this side would be Marysville Township.
Coming west would be Marysville Township.
I think so.
So I guess the next thing is to find out who owns the street. Are you putting that down?
Mm-hmm.
So we can research that. The interlocal agreement with the county would just, it would be so they would allow us to do assessments to those. That's how the interlocal agreement would read?
Well, yeah, I mean, I guess in so many words, if they were opposed to having, you know, quote unquote, their residents be assessed, then the city may not have a way to assess this improvement district onto those properties, and it would fall back to either the city or the properties in the improvement district within the city limits.
Okay. All right, so the next thing is to find out who owns the road. Maybe just have a conversation with Marcus, pose a question to him, and then we'll proceed to the next meeting. Is that okay? You guys are right with that?
Start.
Yep.
We'll start with those two things to find out. You got it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
The next item on the agenda from my section was the swimming pool sales tax fund. My understanding, again, from the previous meeting that I did not attend, was that the council had voted on me submitting a request to the Attorney General for an opinion, a formal Attorney General opinion. I'm not sure if the council was aware of this, if it would have changed the council's opinion, but I felt like before I did that, I needed to advise the council that the Attorney General's office has a procedure and policy before submitting those, and that's that it, for a municipality, it goes through the city attorney, that before that city attorney submits a question, that city attorney conduct all the research he or she can and actually come to a legal conclusion. And then that is basically you're confirming, affirming or not that conclusion, as I understand the policy of the Attorney General's office. So I had not done that at the time that this council had asked me to do that, and I didn't feel comfortable in submitting that until I did. And part of that was researching statutory law, case law, attorney general opinions, and also, maybe most importantly, talking to bond counsel that was responsible and helped assisted the city in the bonds that were issued that were related to, as I understand the history of this, related to that sales tax ballot initiative. Although treated separately, and it was done through a public building commission, and there's a very large bond transcript that some on this council may be aware of and some may not, that referenced the 2013 bonds, and that's these bonds that were issued related to a swimming pool project. And after that conversation and some further review of some of the the ordinances and the statutes, and I wrote down in a little memo sort of my thoughts and I guess many conclusions or sub-conclusions to it that should be in front of you. But again, I wanted to focus on what the question was that was being posed to me and then ultimately potentially posed to the Attorney General's office. And I think it evolved over time, but what I understood it to be at the last meeting where that request was made or that vote was taken was to determine the purpose of that sales tax that was voted on by a ballot measure in 2012 and if it was a general sales tax. And the implication, as I think the council probably already understands, is the statute allows for a longer duration if it's a general purpose tax versus a special purpose tax, which is limited to 10 years. And in my conversation with bond counsel and reviewing the ordinances, I believe that it's a general purpose sales tax and still is, and therefore could be assessed for 20 years, as I think it was intended to. Again, mm-hmm. that's people talking about it sort of from their recollection, including bond counsel. I don't think that's expressly stated, or maybe it is in ordinance language, that 20-year mark. But I believe when Rick Inns got together with the city to determine, number one, what should that sales tax percentage be? There's a point six. Right? Mm-hmm. That's all related to, I think, what the city at that time had determined the payout duration to be on those bonds. Again, is my understanding. But back to the question that I understood being posed to my office or to me was, is this a general bond with the ordinance that were passed? And I believe that it was. And I think that some of the question that came in was, in part, the ordinance that created a swimming pool sales tax fund. And I spoke with bond counsel about that, and we both agreed that fund might have just been more directive than anything or instructive, because it really doesn't have a lot of enforceability. It basically just almost created a middleman, if you will, in the form of a fund with a name, but it doesn't really say how it gets paid out. But as I understand it, how it's been paid out is just paying towards the bonds. But it certainly doesn't require the city to do that. And in fact, I don't see anything sales where those proceeds from that ballot initiative were formally pledged to anything. It's just the city's been operating in that way. It's pledged them more informally to the bonds, because the city has an obligation through that public building commission lease that those bonds have to be, or that it has to be paid, rent has to be paid back through that lease. That's a different kind of question that the city has to determine. If it's not going to apply those sales tax proceeds to the payment of the bonds, what will be applied to the payment of the bonds, because there's, the city has an obligation of some, on some level to do that. But I don't see anything that formally pledges that revenue to anything, including that ordinance number 1800 that creates this swimming pool sales tax fund.
So the way the ordinances are set up, can we use those monies other than for swimming pool operations?
Yes, I believe that the city could.
So if it has like $1 million in there and we decide we're going to be our own banker and borrow that, use that money to pay for street improvements, let's say, and then have the ad valorem taxes pay that money back instead of going out and get a debt instrument, we could do that?
It's an interesting question, and I don't know that I'm comfortable answering that, because that's, I think, you're talking about adding a different kind of debt service. From a legal standpoint, it might be.
Where we're our own banker?
Yeah. I think it's getting a little bit more complicated than just the more basic question of, we have this money, how can we spend it? If you're talking about using it to issue more debt, I don't know. I have an answer for that sitting here.
It would be using it to prevent more debt. And in fact, since it is a general purpose, not a specified specific for the pool, because that would have taken that down to 10 years. A general bond made it stretch out to 20 years. And aren't we almost required to use it for that? Yep. I mean, to save that money and not spend it on anything but the pool, that would make it specific. That would change the structure of the bond.
I don't think that the city is required in such a way.
I don't want to put words in your mouth, but if I'm understanding this correctly, there's permissive versus prescriptive, whereas permissive allows us to do things, prescriptive requires us to do things, right? We can spend it on anything, but it doesn't require us to spend it on any specific thing. Is that correct?
That's my understanding of reading that ordinance of the ballot initiative, that an act of the ballot initiative, and then the ordinance adopting the vote, the result of that vote.
So is that just a loophole then? Because we would have been confined to 10 years, what, at a higher rate, if we had specified it for the pool. Now, this is what I heard Rick Inn say. But if it was general and could be used on anything, because he said that if the pool never needed it and we had made it specific, we could never spend that money. So that's why we needed to make it general, and also it'd stretch it out to 20 years. But if we never ever intended to, or never ever did spend that on anything in the city but the pool, then haven't we kind of found a loophole that we could make it a specific bond issue, and then we just decided we're not going to spend it on anything but the pool?
I think the reason this specific bond issue is statutorily required is because people, the legislature thought that maybe the entities creating these bond issues wouldn't be trustworthy, so they wanted to put that 20-year window on so that it would. My understanding of the reason that was created, because I don't know, Craig, how old that statute is that creates the 10-year requirement on specific issues, but I don't think that was originally there. I think that was added later because people were making it too broad, and that way it would limit us to 10 years so we wouldn't be able to claim and collect it longer than that. I don't think it's a loophole so much as allowing us to keep the interest rates down.
Basically, what you're saying is the way the ordinance is written, it does not transform it into a special purpose bond.
No. In other words, so there's a specific statute whereby you can formally pledge tax revenue. And it can be done by a home rule, and an ordinance done by home rule. And speaking with the bond council, I'm not aware that occurred. That didn't occur with this. There wasn't a formal pledge. The swimming pool tax fund sort of appears to be that, but it doesn't do that. Again, she and I agree that it really doesn't do anything. It's just kind of...
It had to be two separate entities, so we don't have to recognize the debt, the PBC debt, as GO debt on our debt schedule. I mean, I think that was the purpose of doing it, to keep our debt ratio availability.
Perhaps. I don't know. I can't really speak to, you know, the intent or purpose at the time of either the bond or even how the ballot initiative came about. But all I know is, you know, nothing that I see requires or limits the city to maintain whatever intent that was. You know, again, there's pretty broad discretion on how to use those tax revenue. There may be a more political question there on how to do that. That's aside from a legal question that the council could, you know, forever always discuss and debate.
Let me ask one other question then. Let's say that we figured out that we can prepay this pool, let's say in 2022. We have the ordinance set up that those monies are going in, that 0.6% sales tax is going in the swimming pool sales tax fund. Once that debt is paid off, would we still want the money to go into a swimming pool sales tax fund? Or...
Well, again, let me just...
Could we, like, do that for 20 years?
I might caution you on the swimming pool sales tax fund. It's, again, it's just, you're kind of putting it in this nebulous fund that doesn't really do a whole lot. But maybe the question, as I understand it, is if you paid it off, could you continue to have the tax and then figure out where it goes because you don't need it for a pool anymore?
Yeah, would we have to, at that point, separate it out of that fund? Because that fund is described in our ordinance as to be used for operations and...
I don't think you'd have to, but it'd be if you felt more comfortable, out of an abundance of caution, you could very easily repeal that fund. But again, I don't know that it makes much legal difference. You're just kind of displacing it and then paying it how you want. Because as I understand it, the money that's going into that fund is paying these bonds.
Yes, mm-hmm. as well as the pool operations.
Right.
But it's limited on that right now based on the description of the fund in that ordinance number 1800.
Well, it may seem that way, but I'm not sure that it is.
I thought it just specifically said swimming pool operation. It didn't say go on to say in general purposes or anything like that, and other purposes or anything.
Well, it sounds to me like that special fund is just like a savings account that we set up.
You mean the 1800?
Yes.
Swimming pool sales tax?
And at any time, we can do away with it. I mean, it's just a separate little place that we're putting the funds.
It's just like if you took your paycheck and you said, I'm going to put $400 in for a scholarship or a college fund for my kids. Now, there's nobody saying you have to use it for that. Mm-hmm. And you can use it for other things. So that's what he's saying. It may be a political question.
Well, the ordinance has defined what it can be used for. Do you have it right there?
Mm-hmm.
And doesn't it specifically just address swimming pool issues?
It's the language is, and I'll just read it, created a special fund known as the Swimming Pool Sales Tax Fund to be used for the purpose of operation, maintenance, repair, capital, equipment replacement, debt service, and other general pool operation and maintenance needs.
So that's pool and operation mm-hmm. needs. And so it's pretty, it limits you to the pool operation, all those things defined within pool operations.
Yeah, but it says all proceeds in the next paragraph from the 6/10 retailer sales tax shall be credited to the swimming pool sales tax fund. I still don't believe, again, out of the abundance of caution, if the city wanted to repeal, the council wanted to repeal this, just to make it very clear that it's going to spend it on something, a park bench, as maybe was discussed earlier, a baseball field or something, or whatever. It could do that. My conversations with bond council, though, is that this was just a fund created. It was almost arbitrarily done in some ways and doesn't have a lot of enforceability.
So it would be just like if your child didn't go to college, then you took that money out and spent it elsewhere.
Or you had more than enough money to send them to college and you had that excess money.
Well, I think the key thing is that it's saying right now that all monies are going in there and it's to be used for pool operations. So at the point in time that we decide we want to use it for something else, we probably need to repeal that ordinance and have something else in place. As long as we don't lose it after 10 years. That was the whole point of doing this, is to make sure that there's no way that the Kansas Department is revenue or whatever is going to come back and say, well, you know, in de facto, this was a special use bond and not a general use bond. And, mm-hmm. and because after 10 years, we won't have enough money to quite pay it off. And we have ongoing pool operations that we would want to fund from those monies. So just as long as that's not going to happen, I think we're okay.
Yeah, in my opinion, just because of the way the city decides to allocate its revenues doesn't therefore change the purpose of the tax.
Okay.
It's the city just electing to use that tax revenue a certain way, and maybe it's just one way, to pay bonds or to pay maintenance on the building. But if that tax was voted on as a general purpose tax, which I believe it is from that ballot initiative ordinance, nothing up to this point has changed that. It's still general purpose.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Are you guys okay with that?
Yeah, but I don't think we pay that off, that we should retire that at all. That pool is a money-sucking machine there, and it always is going to be. The pool is for enjoyment. It's not ever going to make money. It's not ever going to break even. So any money that we get, I think it should go on for the 20 years because we're always going to need it for operation.
Okay. Well, in 2021, 2022, 2023, we'll have those deep discussions.
Let's just do.
Is that fair enough?
Mm-hmm. Sounds like it.
Thanks, Craig. Okay. Is there anything else?
No, not on that issue, and I don't have anything else on the agenda.
Okay. Does anybody know a reason for an executive session? Okay, so we'll move along to roundtable. I'll start. Cleanup week I thought went great. They picked up all my materials. I was very happy. So I think they did a great job. And someone had complained about dandelions on 20th Street, and I caught Wilbur spraying there. So that made the resident very happy. So I'm glad they got those sprayings done. Glad to see water in the pool. And the last thing I just wanted to tell you about the mayoral conference, a lot of it was about leadership style, decision making, but it was a really good class. It talked about one of the things it was talking about, you know, talking about overthinking something versus a knee jerk versus, you know, how you make decisions and, you know, understanding how you make those decisions. And it was the four types of communication styles was goal setting, lifestyle, stability, and information. And I am totally wired for information. And but the key thing about that is that there are drawbacks from each of those. And as I looked at those four different categories, I put the different people on my council and where I thought you guys fit in that. Oh. And we're pretty balanced, just so you know. So, but anyway, it was very good about leadership style, decision making, crucial conversations, and all good stuff. So, just wanted to report that the conference, although it was 4.5 miles away, but the City Administrator car worked great, so thank you, Austin. No tickets or anything. All right. Bill, you're up first.
I don't have anything.
Darlene?
Oh, nothing yet.
Brad?
Dump trucks look great. The new trucks look
great. Yeah.
That's exciting. Happy
did you put those out just for us?
Yeah, we can go out and look at them. I'll start them up for you. And
show them how they work.
Show them how they work.
They all work?
They all work. They all work great. I won't dump the beds, but
you won't put us in the back and dump us.
Well,
like they kept threatening us in the
tree over.
But no, after this is all over, we can go out and look at the dump trucks. All three of the dump trucks are sitting out there. We can turn them all on.
Right. Where are those going to be, Austin? So we can go inspect them later.
What do you mean? Where
are they
going to
live?
Street department. Yep.
Okay. So they'll be down on the street department.
Yep.
Okay. Thank you.
Todd?
The trees around the northwest our yard over here look nice. I think that the property we sold to Westar for their north yard across from Alston, those look nice. That they planted them all the way around, and including in between a couple existing trees, but apparently they don't plan on those trees lasting forever, I guess. I don't know, I'm not the Westar expert, but...
I don't know anything.
Maybe Bill planted them, heck, I don't know. It was a retiree project.
There you go.
So I thought that looked nice, and I thought that was good since they said they were going to do it, they got on it, so that's it.
Vicki?
I have nothing this evening, thank you.
Denny?
Nope.
Kevin?
Nope.
All right, well, I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
Move to adjourn.
Second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We are adjourned. An hour and 45 minutes. Is that a record?
Oh, no.
We're working on that.
We're working on 2 hours or less. 2 hours less.
Oh, wow. I'm in.
So we succeeded.
Oh.
Can you highlight just like what happens with the Austin?
Yeah, Austin.
Monarchs.
Congratulations.
I guess we should have said that. And the round table. Shame on us.
Be riding in that for the next day.
We'll be happy either way. What's the funny part is our mothers. Well, my mom has two granddaughters and two grandsons. She's kind of freaking out a little bit. Her mom has 8 grandsons. So she
could take a granddaughter.
She could take a granddaughter.
Well, this is going to be a spoiled grandchild then, huh? With all those grandchildren.